University, who is giving the third talk, because he gave a beautiful talk last year, and Manuel Carlos gave another beautiful talk about the joint work with Shaoshi, and now the same Manuel, I think, is also mentioned here. So it's all a very good click, and I'm looking forward to your talk. As usual, we're going to take Shaoshi out for dinner at 6:45 at the usual place. If you'd like to join us, please let me know immediately after the talk. Okay.
Thanks for giving me a second chance to give a talk here. So today I'm going to talk about how to construct test buffers for a rational function of three variable, which is come from when you enumerating three-dimensional works. So by this so-called residue approach. This is a joint work with Manuel Carlos from RISC and Michael Singer from NC State. So as I said, this work is motivated by the problem of enumerating three-dimensional works. And I will reduce this enumeration problem into the telescoping problem. Here the telescoping problem is I take a rational function of three variables in x, y, z, and I would like to construct a linear differential operator in x, such that you apply this operator L to f, this rational function, is equal to the sum of two derivatives. And before I answer in this telescoping problem, I will first start the so-called integrability problems. In some sense, the integrability problem is to test whether one is a telescope for f or not. So, because let me first just briefly recall the history of faster Jabber algorithm. So, in the 1978, Gosper presented an idea to decide here if f is Hilbert return. Gosper gave an argument to decide whether this hypergeometric function is a difference of another.
You have to explain. This is the
yeah. This is the continuous analog of Gosper's algorithm. But it is in for Gosper algorithm here only one difference. Yeah. Here I have two
and
derivatives.
Is it difference operators or not derivative?
Here is derivatives.
It's derivatives.
Yes.
So it's continuous.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we first answer this kind of.
So the continuous analog of Gosper.
Yes, continuous analog in bivariate. So, and then
not everybody is familiar with Gosper. Maybe you have to give a little bit more details.
Yeah, later I will give a talk. Yeah. You give a insert. And the idea is I first answer this question, and then the thing, like a faster Gosper Zeiberg algorithm, which is based on the answer for this kind of question. So, then we...
So, K is a field,
yes.
And K of Y, Z is a rational function in Y and Z.
Yes, definitely. Okay. And then the answer for this will lead to an idea to solve this problem. So let me take one example, which is so-called three-dimensional Rook walks. So now you are stay in this first quadrant of this three-dimensional space. And the Rook is in the chess, you can move on this direction arbitrarily many steps, or in this direction arbitrarily many steps. Or this direction. So there are three different directions you can move. For instance, when in this cubic, when you only move in this cubic space, and then you move from the origin to the point 111, and then you can enumerate this Rook walks. There are six different Rook walks. And the question now is, how you can calculate the number of the different Rook walks from the origin to arbitrarily n. So you want to have this sequence Rn. So you know in the combinatorics, there's a very natural way to compute a sequence is you would like to find a linear recurrence for this Rn. And then the way to find a linear recurrence for a sequence, usually we reduce the problem to find the differential equation for the generative function of this sequence. So to get the generative function, let me encode this problem by this so-called diagonals. So here, now let f, m, m, n, m, n, k, the number of different Rook walks from the origin to the to the arbitrary integer point in the three-dimensional space. And then it turns out that the generative function for this 3-dimensional sequence is very simple. It's just this simple rational function. And then my original question is actually to compute the diagonal of this rational function. So here, the diagonal, what's the minimal diagonal? Is you take this coefficient and then you form this univariate generative function. We call this univariate generative function the diagonal of this capital F.
Note that. Let me just explain to the audience why this generating function. So it's a geometric series. So a hook can either walk in the x direction, the y direction, either go to x square, x cube. So that's why you have the first term. Then we go in the y direction,
the
y.
Yeah, this is correct.
Yeah, so it's a sigma of x over 1 as x over 1, and it can have any number. So that's why you get a geometric series. So it's a generating function for going from the origin to any location.
Is this, yes, right. Note that here, f, n, and n is just the number of Rn. So now the idea is to get a linear recurrence for Rn, I would like to get a linear differential equation satisfied by this diagonal. There is a very classical lemma, is reduce this problem to so-called telescopic problem. So first, you take this rational function, and then you do this transformation. You should observe that after this transformation, the f tilde is still rational function in x, y, z. So f tilde is still rational function. And now you try to find a linear differential operator L if this L satisfies this, later I will call this telescoping equation, then you can claim that this L annihilates this diagonal. So now the problem is how you can find a linear differential L such that this is satisfied for F tilde. And this L is called a telescoper for F tilde. So this is the problem of constructing telescopers for rational function in three variables. So you have this f in this rational function of three variables in x, y, and z, and then you would find this L. Related to this problem, I will study another problem. Actually, I will only try to find a telescoper for bivariate functions, but it's not rational. Now it's more complicated, is algebraic function. So here, the number of variables reduced to 2, but the complexity of the function class from the rational to algebraic. So now, but I will, in this talk, actually the goal is to show that these two questions actually is equivalent, by the sense that if you have answer to this question, then you have the answer to this question, and vice versa. So now how you can build the connection between those two problems, the idea is residue. Before I prove the equivalence between those two telescoping problems, I first prove the equivalence between the following two integrability problems. The first question is, if a rational function f in y and z is said to be rational integrable with respect to y and z, if you can find the g and the h such that this equation is true. So here we should emphasize that g and h are still rational function in y and z. Otherwise, this problem makes no sense because you can always integrate a continuous function. And another integrable problem is you start from an algebraic function alpha y just in one variable y. You want to decide whether there is another algebraic function, beta is still algebraic function, such that alpha is equal to the derivative of beta. And if such a beta exists, then I will say alpha is algebraic integrable with respect to y. And I will show that those two questions actually are the same. Now let me first define what is residue for rational function. Here you view this f as a rational function in z, and then the y is just a parameter. And then you can you can always expand this rational function f over the algebraic closure of the e y, and then you have this partial fraction decomposition. And then the residue at a certain root, beta I, actually is this just this coefficient when this j is 1. So this, I denoted by this residue f at this pole beta I. So this is like our, the definition here actually is the same like the residue in the complex analysis, because complex analysis, you expand this function as the Rohm series, and you take the coefficient at this power with minus 1. It's here actually it's the same, but just you expand this, here is more algebraic, because when you work with a rational function, you can do partial fraction decomposition. And there is some very simple lemma which show the property of this residue. So the first, you can see here, I expand this rational function with respect to z. So do this partial fraction decomposition with respect to z. And then you can show that this residue with respect to z commutes with, when you take a derivative with respect to y. So because this is the commutivity between the derivation with respect to y and the residue with respect to z. You can, by definition, you can check this. Another very important property is this one. So this one says if a rational function f is equal to derivative of another rational function, and then the necessary and severe condition is all residue vanish. So this is if and only if condition. But later you will see that this property will not be true if f is algebraic function. So this is only true for rational function. Now there is a very classical lemma result which is due to Picard in 100 years ago. And he showed that if this rational function in y and z is rational integrable with respect to y and z, and the necessary and severe condition is you check the residue at the root of this denominator, and then you should note that the residue now is an algebraic function in y. So the Picard's condition is if that is true, and then all residue is algebraic integrable. So Picard actually, this result show that the problem of the integrability problem for bivariate rational function is equivalent to the integrability problem for univariate algebraic functions. Let me take some example to show how you can use this criteria. So first, let me take this f 1 over y plus z. And then, now you look at so the denominator is z plus y, so the root with respect to z is minus y. So, and then, you know, the residue, if you calculate residue, actually the residue is just 1. And then, because 1 is derivative of another by this residue, is algebraic integrable. And then by this criteria, then you can see that f is rational integrable with respect to y and z. In fact, you can explicitly find this g and h. So, and let's see another very simple example. Now you take 1 over y times z, not y plus z, now it's y times z. And then the root is, you know, the root is just 0, because if you view this as a polynomial in z, and this is the root is 0. And then the residue is 1 over y. And you can prove that 1 over y is not algebraically integrable. So yeah, then by this Picard's criteria, you can claim that there's no rational function g and h such that f equal to this. So after my talk, if you have time, you can try this exercise. And now we have this equivalence between two integrability problems. And you can easily, actually, in my paper, I show that you can from the integrability between equivalence between two integrability problems, you can get the equivalence between the two telescopic problems. So let's just restate this equivalence. So you have a rational function f in y, x, y, and z. And then if you can find a telescoper for this rational function f, if and only if you can if underneath L, at this telescope, L is the telescope for every residue of F respect to Z. When you take the residue of respect to Z, and then now the residue became eigen function in X and Y. So here is telescoping for Russian function of three variables. Here is telescoping problem for eigen function in two variables. And actually they are equivalent. One remark is, when you take a residue, given a one rational function, actually there are many pools you can take a residue. So the way to combine all those telescopes is, you can, if you find all the telescopes for all residues, then you can take this LCLN. This is called this least common left multiple. You can, you know, you have polynomial, you can take an LCM. But here, the polynomial is differential operator. It's not commutative. So this is why I have this left multiple. Okay, now the problem for constructing telescopes of rational function in three variables is reduced to the problem of computing telescopes for algebraic function in two variables. Now I present a way to find the telescope for algebraic functions. When you work with algebraic functions, it's better to view this algebraic function as a differential form. So the idea is actually start from any algebraic function, you can form this algebraic function field. And then on this algebraic function field, you can formally define this so-called differentials. If you do the differential over this fx, and then all f is viewed as a constant. And in some sense, you just view fx as a constant. And then in the derivative, because you take this differential form with respect to y, and then this differential form commutes with this derivative with respect to x. And then you can, for algebraic function, like a Russian function, you can still define the residues. But now for algebraic functions, there are no partial fraction divisions. So you can only work locally, you cannot work globally. So the idea is this, in the very classical result, you can define the so-called place, actually place like rational function at the pole, but it's not, you cannot see the pole, but here we can define the kind of place. For technical reason, I assume that this place is not, has no ramification. And then, because this is has no ramification, and then I can find a uniform parameter t. I can expand this algebraic function beta as a Lohmann theory. And then the definition of residue is the same in the complex analysis. I take this coefficient as the residue of this function at this place. And here, now for this residue, I have only one property, is because this Lohmann theory, I take this Lohmann theory with respect to y, and then this residue is commutes with the derivative with respect to x. But then I have no the second property is, if this algebraic function is derivative of another algebraic function, if and only if the order residue are zero, this property will not be true in this for algebraic function. But still, there is a weaker property of algebraic function and the residues. So there is a result which you can, if you have this fx, this k, capital K, denote this algebraic function field. And then you take any algebraic function from k, you can always write this theta as this a fraction a over b. Now a is the algebraic function is a polynomial in this alpha, and the b is just a rational function. I mean, it's not an algebraic function. You can view b as a polynomial in y, and then you can take the square free part of b with respect to y. And there's a result which show that for any algebraic function, you can always find a linear differential operator L such that when you apply this L to alpha, and then this alpha has all residue zero. And also you can bind the order of this differential operator L. So as I said, there are some algebraic function has all residue are zero, but still is not the derivative of another edge function. And this kind of edge function is called second kind. So if you have edge function and you form this differential form, and then if all residue are zero, then we say this differential form is second kind. There's a very nice result that even though there exist many second kind, but if you view all these second kind differentials over the exact differentials, and then you view this as a linear space over the constant fx, then this linear space has finite dimension, and the dimension actually is exactly twice of the genus of the edge function field. So this is
sorry. I hate to interrupt you. This is a beautiful talk, but I think most people are lost. So I suggest forget about the slides and give a new talk on a much lower level. That's the big picture motivation to the general audience. So that's a beautiful talk, but not for this audience. Uh-huh. So forget about the slides and go to the blackboard, and that gives a big picture, give a complete elementary introduction. Okay. Sorry. So, time out. So, turn off the slides.
Actually, the nice thing is later you will see the example. Then you.
Oh, so maybe you can skip because this is you lost even me. Uh-huh. It's too advanced. So, and some of them are first year graduate students.
Okay.
So, so you can still use it, but I think I suggest because you're such a great speaker and. Last year was very accessible, so this talk is way too advanced, even for me. So I suggest you just give the big picture and without details, that's what it's good for. Like the book is a great example.
Let's just take this
example. So say what it's good for, but not by genus.
Return back to our original Rook walk. So for this Rook walk, so you have this rational function, as I said, is this 1 over 1 minus x over 1 minus x and plus y, and this then you do this transformation. This just the
Can I help you in some motivation? But the book. It's a paper that Manuel Kraus and I wrote a few years ago about the Rook walks. So you know in the chessboard, two-dimensional chessboard, you want to ask how many ways can a rook walk from the origin to a point m comma n. So if you just have not a rook, but just a king, a forward moving king, then the generating function, if you have zero steps, it's one. If you have one step, it's either x plus y. If you have two steps, so the generating function in two dimensions for a king that only can move forward is, sorry, not a king. A king is also this.
Yes.
If it's a king, it'd be like this. These are the fundamental steps of a king, is x, y, forward, positive going king, x, y, and x, y. So if it's like a rook, so it can only go in one, so it is a geometric series. So this is the generating function. Let's say Manhattan walks. If you walk in Manhattan and you only go this and this, this is the generating function. It's a rational generating function. And if you are not interested in going to the diagonal, Mn, you take the diagonal of this. Now another question, but if it's a rook, every atomic step can be either x or x squared or x cubed, da da. So this is the generating function for going in the x direction, and similarly in the y direction. And if it's a three-dimensional chessboard, so if you look at all the possibilities, so this is one atomic step. So you have this rational function, you have this. Now, if you're interested only in what's going in diagonal N and N, you take the diagonal of this. And then it'd be interesting to find. So I say, now it's only one variable, because you only look at diagonal. You look at sigma R N N N, z to the power N. So you want to compute it fast. So the best way is a closed form. So closed form, for example, if you only have Manhattan walks in three dimensions, there is a nice explicit multinormal coefficients. But that's usually not possible. So the next best thing is a linear recurrent equation with polynomial coefficients. In this case, if A of N, so it is equivalent, closed form, if you take the quotient, A of N plus 1 of A M, it's a nice thing. So it's the first order recurrence. So the next best thing to a closed form is like Fibonacci, except that's got the coefficients. So this will compute fast. So what Shaoshi is looking at, a fast way to find a recurrence for R and N. And equivalently, a linear differential equation satisfied by this. So this is motivation.
Yes. Okay. So let me continue this because Nolan already explained what's the rational function of this. And then you do this transformation of this rational function. And then you get this rational function. So even it's big, but still it's rational function in x, y, and z. And then, as I said, you look at this residue. Actually, residue is just a certain algebraic function. You compute this, you expand this power theory as a partial fraction dimension with vector z, and then you get those two residues. So those two residues are edge function. Here you can see this edge function. This is not abstract, no genius and no nothing. And even you can observe that actually this is hyper exponential function. So as I in the map, you can, if this is a edge, is a hyper exponential function. So let me explain what is hyper exponential function. Hyper exponential function is if you take a derivative of this one and then you over this function, that is a rational function. You can check this is hyper exponential function. So hyper-exponential is just satisfy a first order differential equation. Here is for hypergeometric is first order difference equation. So actually for each hyper-exponential function, you can construct telescope. So here you see for this hyper-exponential function, the telescope is of order 3. And then for this simple, this is a simple residue, and then you can find this very simple telescope. And then how you can combine these two
things? Yeah, this is the recurrent for R and N. Then enables you to compute the first 100,000 very fast.
Yes. And then you take this so-called LCLN. You forget LCLN. And in MAPL, everything can help you. You can take LCLN of two operator. Then you can get the true telescope for this original input. Now you will get this. So now you get this L. And then there is a very mechanical way is you can convert this linear differential equation to the recurrence for the sequence R. So in G phi you can do this. And then you can get this linear recurrence. You see, this is a linear recurrence of order 4. Actually, it's very nice to have linear recurrence because you can get the next turn linearly, in linear time. You don't need to go gather all the data in the three dimension. We only need the linear data. And then if you, because as I showed that when here n is 1, the number of the loop is 6. And then you can, because you need the sufficient many initial condition. Here the order is 4.
It's much faster, because if you take the generating function in x, y, and z, you have to have a three variable generating function. So you have a cubic memory, and then you take the diagonal. So it is much faster to find the first 1,000 terms.
Okay, then you only need a 4 initial value. Actually, you can do this because for when the number is small, you can just do this naive way because you can just work with a generic function, you can get some where n is small. But when n is very large, you need this recurrence. This is why with recurrence you can get even bigger. You can imagine if this you do this by hand, for this number is hopeless. So this is why we need a computer to do this. So for this example, you can see that we can get the recurrence from computing telescopes. Let's forget complicated thing. And then this idea has implemented in Mathematica. And actually there are two existing implementations, which is